Right. According to the clock at 6 o'clock, we have a couple of items of business at the board that we need to act upon. First of all, is the change of the meeting time for our next meeting on April the 2nd from 9 o'clock to 8 o'clock. Do I hear a motion that we do that?
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Also, we need to set the date for a public hearing, and we anticipate doing that at that meeting. Do I hear a motion that we set that public hearing for that meeting?
So moved. You're talking about the EDC?
Talking about the EDC. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
So ordered. Chairman will now open the public hearing for our capital improvements program, and I'm going to recognize our interim county manager and CFO, Ms. Minner, to lead us through that discussion.
Purpose of tonight's public hearing is to hear public comments on the recommended capital improvements program presented by then County Manager David Smitherman on February 26, 2007. This was a culmination of requests received through December of 2006 that were compiled. The recommendation of the manager was to shift projects accordingly, and we were looking at a recommendation that would take a 6.49 cent tax levy in this year of reval to fund the CIP that's presented. The public hearing notice did run accordingly, and the CIP document has been available for public inspection in the clerk's office and at the library since presented.
All right, do I hear anyone who wants to speak in favor of the CIP as it has been recommended?
Mr. Brown, we have four people that have signed up to speak.
All right.
Okay, the first one is John Altenbrunner.
Is this for or against?
They're all for.
I want four. Okay, all of them that are for, please approach the podium, state your name and your address.
For what? What you just did?
Yeah.
With CIP.
I'm not sure if what I'm talking about is in the CIP or not.
It is in the CIP.
It is in the CIP. I'm in favor of it.
All right, you have 3 minutes. Oh. That's our rule for public hearing.
Well, thank you so much for letting me come here. Let me just share with you, and this one just passed over. My name is John Altenbrunner. I have lived here since in Lee County since 1996, 1997. I joined the CCC as a volunteer math teacher in the adult high school and GED program, and I've been doing that ever since. Wonderful experience. After about 3 years, that is in about the year 2000, plus or minus, my memory isn't real good either, Mr. Reeves, the school moved the GED adult high school education program to the Jonesboro branch, which was the vacated Jonesboro Elementary School. It was a quantum loss in facilities, let me just say that. And if you just go over there and drive around it without even going inside, you can see the chipping paint and broken windows and very, very deteriorated value of that, that building. It's certainly totally detracted from the campus atmosphere that we had in the main campus. I could even take you inside and you would see matching holes between the window and the Venetian blind where a bullet had gone through. The air conditioning and heating system in the room that I happen to be in has got a thermostat, but we really regulate the temperature and the comfort of the students by the doors and windows. On the average, the students are happy and comfortable. Half of them cold, half of them hot. Teachers and administrators manage the students and they progress very nicely, and graduation occurs on a regular basis in great quantity. if I were a recent college graduate and I was interviewing and attending that campus, asking, let me work, once I saw that building, I would go elsewhere, I would not work there. For those of us that have been around for a few years, we remember the good old days finally, I would strongly support phasing this facility out as soon as practicable and provide quality facilities on the main campus. Thank you very much. If you have any questions?
Thank you, John.
Yes, sir.
Who's next?
Hazel Kaiser.
Good evening. My name is Hazel Tyson, I'm a Dulles High School pre-GED instructor at the Jonesboro site. And I'm just here to ask that you give some consideration and a facility for us. And I'm just gonna go recent with what happened today. Because of the temperatures was low today, the class was cold, even I was cold. My feet are still cold. That's why I'm wearing a sweater, hoping that the heat will go down to my feet. The conditions are really terrible and we're doing the best we can, but if you can, please give some consideration to the Jonesboro Center. Maybe a new facility, if possible. Thank you.
Thank you.
Astro Hernandez.
And then?
Good evening, everyone. My name is Astro Hernandez. I am a former student of the Central Carolina Community College at the Jonesboro Center. I am now attending the main campus. I am studying business administration. I want to say that I'm very thankful, and I'm speaking from my heart, with the Jonesboro Center at the basic skills, because they gave me education I needed to move forward in my life. I am now working at the Jonesboro Center. Unfortunately, like they say, we don't have the best building, it's an old one. And to add to what they say, when it rains, the roof leaks in the office. And to get in or out the office, you will get wet. So I take this opportunity to ask you, please find a better way. Please find a way to replace the Jonesboro Center with a better one. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Sue Tipton.
Hello, I'm Sue Tipton. I'm the counselor at Central Carolina Community College Jonesboro Center. And just today, I took a plant manager of the company to show him and his wife our building, which was quite shocking, I'm sure, to him. But, you know, a lot of times people come to me and I give tours of our building, and it's pretty rough when you know there's mildew in classrooms that I think is very dangerous. We have asbestos, I think, somewhere in our building. We have a lot of things that are just not humanly possible to have people in the building working in. And yet we're there every day, and it worries me, especially with young people that maybe are pregnant or having babies or going to have some children, because we do not know what this site is causing for these children. And I, as a parent of two grown-up adults, you know, would certainly not want to have my grandchildren affected by being in this space. I'm an older lady, so I'm okay. I figure, you know, you go when you go. But, you know, I care about my students, and I really feel like it's just unbelievable to have us there. And so we're looking at you to help us out. And I appreciate anything you can do to help us move this building forward. We need to start having fundraisers or whatever we can do to help in any way. I know our students would be willing to do it. We have the SGA, and Ms. Tyser helps lead them, and they can earn money if that's what they need to do, or anything else that's possible, because we need to move it a little faster than 2011, which is sort of what I'm looking at as a possibility, maybe, because 5 years in that building is not good for our young teachers, and it's certainly not good for the students either. It's just, the other day it rained and we had to walk in water up to over our calves. You have to move around the campus. You probably need to wear knee boots or something. Some days when it rains. So if y'all visit us, it might be a rainy day, so come prepared, I'll tell you that. But thank you for the hearing.
Thank you, ma'am. And we will be visiting you. We have a joint meeting with the trustees of the community college, and it's going to be held down there at Jonesboro.
And we did have one more speaker that just stepped in a minute late. I didn't know if that's allowed.
Yeah, so Sandra, you're welcome to speak.
Okay, thank you.
I'd like to say thank you for this opportunity. This is my third time being before you. I am the basic skills recruiter for the campus. And I would like to say that when I go out to recruit, I recruit students for the campus because I'm proud of the school. I'm proud of the teachers, I'm proud of the faculty, I'm proud of the whole school because we have great teachers there. They work hard, they go way beyond just to do for the students. But when I go out to recruit, I'm ashamed to tell them what kind of place they're gonna have to attend. Because if I try to make it sound like they're going to a nice campus, I'll be really telling them a wrong. But I go out and recruit every day for this campus. And today, we didn't have heat, we didn't have hot water. When we go in the bathrooms are cold, the water is cold. That's not only in the student's bathroom, but inside the basic skills office. So I would just like to say that I've been before you three times. And it's because I care for the campus and I care for the students. And I would ask you to please consider giving us a new building. That when I go out to recruit, I can not only say that you're going to have great teachers, the faculty is great, but the school is also great. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. So you got one more?
That's
it. Oh, that's there. Okay. All right. All right, now those are speaking for, or there are those who are present who want to speak against the capital improvement plan as has been presented. And if the commissioners have any comments? If there are none, then I will declare the public hearing closed, and we appreciate the input that you had. It looked like y'all got together and other folks didn't, so that says something to me.
I have
yeah.
Okay. Can you tell me what your hours of operation and the number of students that you currently have enrolled down at Delta Center? Anybody?
Yeah, I can tell you pretty much that. I think we have about 1,000 students enrolled, is my understanding.
Wow.
And usually in the daytime we have like 300 or so. And of course we have other classes, nursing classes, art classes, computer classes that are continuing ed classes. We're all working in basic skills, all those of us who are here right now. But then at nighttime, you would not believe it, there is parking three deep, even in the parking lots and places, all over the lawns, everywhere. We probably have over 400 people, many, many nights. They're just basic skills, and that doesn't count all the nursing students and the other. We usually have two sections of nursing going on at the same time. This is the CNA program, and sometimes we'll have phlebotomy and just lots of different health type courses, as well as our basic skills and our English as a second language and our GED program.
And HRDs.
And yeah, human resources development also, who works with the Employment Security Office and helps people get jobs and do their resumes. They have workshops going on also continuously. So there's a lot of people there. And I was just quoting figures for basic skills, and I think I'm pretty accurate on that.
So you open at what time? And
oh, 8 o'clock in the morning. We're really there more like 7:30 till 9 o'clock at night. So there's people there continuously all day long.
Thank you.
I know the place stays covered up with automobiles.
You're right. You know all about that.
Well, I've already closed the public hearing, so we'll now move into the work session portion of our meeting. And again, I recognize Ms. Memphis. I think we're going to move over to Gordon Wicker Room. Okay, so we'll move over to Gordon Wicker Room.
Good.
I said
that
was you normally
like
your
room
spread
out, so.
Well, I put the thing out Yeah, well, it's all right, we'll just stay here.
Can you help an extra one?
I should have said to begin with, Mr. Pascal had another meeting, and I excused him for the public hearing and also for this work session. Okay? Go ahead.
The work session was scheduled for further input from the Board of Commissioners on CIP prior to your adoption of the CIP, hopefully at the next board meeting. At this point, staff needs guidance on how you want to structure the projects. The goal for this coming budget is to set a four-year tax rate, so the structuring of these programs will play into the tax amount that we need to add to the tax rate to cover the debt for the next 4 years.
Knowing what you know right now, how much money are we going to be able to expend in the coming fiscal year?
If you do not want to raise taxes immediately, you could only do about $2 million more in the coming fiscal year without raising taxes for that. We have stretched our debt limits. I mean, our debt, we're okay on our debt limits. You just can't do much more without a tax increase. And if you remember, we were looking at, we looked at it for just the high school alone project. We were looking, the amounts we were looking at there, if you back that down, you can only do about $2 million. I'm talking to Davenport Friday without a tax increase. Now that's just for the 1 year. That doesn't still look out to what you may want to do over the next 4 to 5 years. Whatever you do over $2 million is gonna more than likely require a tax increase. Obviously, as you look at it from year to year, it's on a vary.
Lisa, earlier you said that things in this would require a 6.9 cent levy?
6.49.
What is it?
6.49, based on the recommendation that was given to you on February 26th. We did receive additional information from the schools today adjusting their requested CIP. They I'm glad to pass that out if y'all would like to see that. This information does reflect an increase for the high school. You know, they've got more recent numbers. They also have redone their technology project based on information at the retreat where they had put in items that were more capital outlay items than construction items. So they reevaluated that, removed technology phase 2 and phase 3, and lowered the cost of technology phase 1. They also, in the place of the technology projects, as you probably remember from the retreat, the schools reported that based on Don Kovaskett's numbers, there would probably be a need for a second elementary school. They had requested one in their original CIP, but in this revision that they've provided us, they have asked for land for a second location of another elementary school. So, these numbers alone could play into some differential. However, what you probably are dropping in the first couple of years for the technology projects are being incorporated, being absorbed by the high school going up from what we originally had in the CIP, recommended CIP.
Now these funds spread out over a 3 year period would not require a referendum, right? They're gonna have that in their operating budget?
No.
Capital improvement budget of their own?
No, sir. We would still have to fund those, and it would have to be either based on the resolution you've already passed, it would have to be through a bond referendum to borrow it to come up with that kind of funding. Now, my understanding is they have adjusted, the project was a not to exceed $25 million. This total was $24 million. 547,742, and that reflects the removal of the renovations to the gym that they will have in their capital outlay request coming to you on April 4th for budget consideration. That, along with additional proceeds to continue to pay height to develop our plans for the high school renovations.
Well, if we did have a referendum and it passed, how much good is it going to do us? and spread it out over 3 years.
It's not going to make that much difference.
Well, that's what I'm thinking.
And talking to Davenport, if you're only spreading it out over 3 years, it's not going to make a significant difference in the debt burden or the ultimate cost, and you have cost of issuance each time you issue.
We still have the obligation, whether we've used it or not.
Right. Well, and you don't start paying until we issue it, but I just don't know that delaying each issue a year is going to save you enough money to lower your tax rate that much.
That's the question I'm asking.
Right. Now, of course, I didn't see these numbers until this afternoon.
My understanding was that they could only do the high school project in stages because of the layout of the campus.
That's correct.
So it is not like they could bite it off all at once anyway.
Right.
Just curious to know how this, looking at the difference, and I don't have the old one now, but, well, maybe I do, I'm sorry. The difference of the $22 million in 07, 08, which is what we have in Exhibit 5, that's that CIP page. The difference in the way that would affect the tax increase versus what they've got laid out was $5.2 million, if that was in 07, 08. Because the way we had it, we were looking at 6.49 cents or whatever.
Right.
And we were thinking that that would be with $22 million, right?
Yes, ma'am.
So now we're looking at, if we get this right, $5.2 million. So how does that adjust that tax rate increase? Because instead of $2 million, we could absorb that and not have a tax increase at all. So then you're looking at an additional 3.2.
Off the cuff, probably about 1 to 2 cents. Now, I have not had Davenport run the numbers. I didn't receive these until late this afternoon, so I have not had Davenport run the numbers and did not look at it that way because I'm still looking at a total project.
Right.
Because to me, it would not be necessarily beneficial to issue over 3 years. If you know what your total is going to be and you're committed to the project, I don't know that it's going to be beneficial to the county to spread it and do three separate issues. If you were only to commit to the 5.2, you would be looking, you could probably do it for, 1 to 2 cents off the cuff. I don't have their run where they did just the high school where we did the several scenarios and it was costing so much per issue.
And I would like to ask, if we've got the chairman here, what the $5.2 million would do for you all in 07 or 08. Is that
all right?
Yeah.
I'm not sure that I'm the appropriate to answer that. That's more to Mr. Pinardi. But what we attempted to do since the retreat and the fact that we had the number of not to exceed $25 million. And after having several board members, commissioner members, tour the campus, we still are at that not to exceed $25 million. It's our understanding that as long as the resolution that was passed by this board in December requesting and requiring us to go to the voters, we have only one shot, only one opportunity to present to the voters for the completed project at Lee County High School. The $5.2 million was a number to begin the process. The architect would need 1 year in planning, 3 years in construction. So the entire project would be over a 4 year project at to not exceed the $25 million. And the exact breakdown on the 5.2, I can't answer.
Okay, so you cannot answer.
I would think it's a, it would take, and it may be in your documents. I've not seen the document. I was unavailable all last week in Dr. McCormick, in defense of Dr. McCormick. Mr. Thompson and I requested that we have an opportunity to review what was being submitted to Lisa. And I think Ms. Mentor had talked to someone over there last week about the revisions, specifically in regards to what the discussion was at the commissioner's retreat on the technology portion of it. And then when we made those revisions, we felt that two other factors needed to be placed in the revision, as Ms. Mentor just mentioned, with Mr. Kabasik's projection of 1,000 additional elementary students over 7 years. It was my choice in asking Dr. McCormick and Tammy Harrington to place that $1.5 million in 2011 for the property acquisition for that ninth elementary school. Also, in lieu of what is occurring currently on Lee County High School's campus, and that being our primary priority at this time, we have taken out the some $300,000 that's going to be, that's a hard number, and of course it's got to go for a bid process, yes. But it's a hard number on re-roofing that school the old gym, before we start losing the flooring in that gym because of the leak. Also, it's included in this that's been deducted out of the $25 million is the science building that some of you have seen. The condition and the shape that science building is in is just the demolition of that building. But again, that's in, we've taken that out, but it's going to be back in the presentation on the current capital needs.
On the demolition of that building, did we talk about going ahead and demolishing that building and put in some mobile units?
Yes, and that'll be in the presentation, but that is a deduct in the sheet that you're looking at now in the high school.
So build back in, will that exceed $25 million?
No, not to exceed $25 million.
Maybe less, maybe. I received a letter dated March 14th from you comparing the 2003 estimate with the estimate that we now have. Mm-hmm. Option A was $27,548. Option B was $29,548, and that was by Boney.
Mm-hmm.
Now, in 2007, Height and Associates concept for 2007 not to exceed $25 million.
Mm-hmm.
What other than the gym is taken out of that? Did Boney have all of the buildings in his?
Boney had pretty much mirrored, and I'm doing this from memory from looking at the two studies. The actual facility study by Boney, from a building standpoint, had mirrored each other pretty well. They were both architectural firms that had recommended that the science building be demolished. The what I call administrative building, I think they call it a language arts building now, but the original 1951 administrative building, the business wing that connects to the administration building, and the original library, and the field house, what is referred to as a field house at the football stadium, those buildings mirrored each other. The two architectural firms mirrored each other in that those buildings should be replaced due to age and the 21st century technology needs. One other building was suggested by each of them also was the current math building. That's still being debated and discussed by the facilities, current facilities committee and the architect, and I know that some of our board members that are not on facilities have some questions about the math bill. But.
What about the auditorium? Is it completely refurbished or doing what was necessary?
In both of those studies, the auditorium needed major renovations. What we've asked as a result of the $25 million number is the value of McLeod Auditorium to the education on the campus, the curriculum of the campus. In my travels around the county, it seems to be a lot of support to renovate McLeod Auditorium because it has a seating capacity in excess of 800 people. The acoustics, I'm told, is excellent. So there's a sentiment in the community that I, as our tribal community, to look at McLeod Auditorium. But that's roughly $2.5 million of the $25 million that we're talking about.
And we talked about that in our tour over there. Mm-hmm.
But Ms. Stevens, I'm sorry, I can't explain the detail of the $5 million. It's, I think it was a matter of the $5 million being some of the engineering and cost, some of the expenses of particular buildings in renovation rather than demolition. It was the buildings that would remain. It's two-thirds of the structures over there need to be re-roofed. I think it would be safe to say that that type, those buildings that would remain would be the priority on that $5 million expenditure.
Am I understanding you correctly that if you went to referendum and it passed, that it would be at least a year before you would do anything?
It would be next summer. If theoretically, hypothetically on timeline, if we work jointly, concurrent, the two boards, and we could meet a November referendum, which is the next opportunity in my mind that we could have a referendum. If that referendum was passed and the financial arrangements were made, we would probably not be in a position to start drawing down. The bid process would not be begun until this time next year, with a bid letting sometime probably in April, and then the mobilization on June the 10th when the students are released for construction mobilization. And then it would be working on timeline with phased. I don't know that we would ever be able to get a general contractor to bid on the entire project because of the length of the project. So it would probably be staged in phase one, and followed by phase two bid letting for what the architect determined should be a schedule of phase one and phase two. Again, though, it's my understanding, and maybe this board could clarify any misunderstanding on my part, is that if I understood what you were saying, when we go to a referendum, we would have to present the full project cost for the selling of the bonds.
Right. When you go to referendum, you would have to request the full amount that you would need for the project. And if it ends up, we ask for $25 million, and over the life of the project it ends up being 30, we have to come up with the rest of the money another way.
But that, again, that's why the document you have today is broken into 3 years, just as a matter of point of reference of the project's duration. But again, when we go to the referendum, it would be for the full amount.
How does that affect us in regards to, say we only use $5 million in the first year? Is that all we pay for?
Depends on how you issue it. I mean, you can choose to sell it in increments, but you incur bond issuance costs each time you sell. And or you can go ahead and issue the full amount at the time. And if it's broken down in two phases and bid in two separate phases, you probably won't have to do two separate bond issuances. I would imagine LGC usually wants to see the bids before they allow you to issue. So depending on how you time it, you can time it where it spreads out the tax burden. But right, if you only sell $5.5 million of it to begin with, that's all you pay on. And then when your debt burden would increase when you sell the next portion.
But your bond rate might change. I mean, the rate of interest.
Right, if you sell at a different time, you're subject to an interest rate change.
You
wouldn't
be locked in.
No, sir. You would only be locked in once you sell the original amount, and each issuance would be a separate transaction. And we would probably have to go through the bond rating process and everything, which is a good $30,000 each time we're rated between the two rating agencies, depending on how closely you issue the two.
So what are total costs in regards if we do it, if we go through this process two or three times? What estimated? I'm not, you know.
Right. You're probably looking at $50,000 to $75,000 for a bond issuance, counting the rating reviews, printing, et cetera, and legal cost.
Anybody else have any questions? Mr. Tatum, appreciate you coming.
Well, I've got one for you.
All right.
Tell me about the East Lee Middle School electric heat. We have that at 1.6 for 07 and 08. How critical is that situation?
We feel like it's a top priority, Mr. Reeves. It's something that's we've pieced together for a number of years, and we feel pretty firm about the about that as a cost for 07-08. We would then also be looking in 08-09, if you notice, for Wesley to have the same HVAC system repairs, replacement.
Well, that was primarily the benefit of the board each time, whether it's one, two, or three phases, and the senior piece, we got $1.6 million and $1.8 million tapped
to deal with you.
For both of those.
Yeah.
So it's not just 5.2.
No, it's the bottom line.
7.4.
It's 7.4.
Well, I see what it is, but when you start talking about it, you tend to forget that you're talking about, you think you're talking about 5.2, and you're talking about 7.4, almost $7.5 million. 9.8 the following year.
Again, maybe it's my own level of confidence, but with the action of the board with renovations and construction, we're looking at that top line on Lee County High School. Current policy by the commissioners is that we would have to go to a referendum for funding. The other items would not be part of a referendum.
You know, I want to say, since I made that comment, that wasn't a policy or a mandate or recommendation to the Board of Education by any means. It was a comment simply said to this board that I felt that it was time, if we looked at building any more school, that the public be included and allowed to vote on.
Mm-hmm.
Wasn't recommending that you go forward, wasn't recommending anything to the Board of Education. And that's not a policy, just a comment. You were elected to take it that way.
Well, Mr. Reeves, in respect to the board, there was an action taken by the board, and we assumed that when the board voted, it was a new policy. It was a policy by the commissioners that renovation and construction would be the responsibility of the Board of Education to present a referendum. And it's our error if we misunderstood the actions of taken by this board on December 4th. There was a vote to that. Yes, in respect to you, I know that was a conversation of comment by you, but it then turned into a form of a motion and approved 7-8. So we're only looking at it. We're looking at it from the action of the board, and we're certainly not looking at it from an adversarial standpoint at all.
Well, when you say that you take it as instruction for you to go to the public, that in my mind was not what it said. It simply said, if we were to consider that, it should go before the public. And even if it does, I don't know that this board has to act, even if the public says, yeah, we want to build a school at that time. The board still has the right to reject based on the information that we have financially, not to keep moving in that direction. I just think that there's a misunderstanding.
I believe at that December the 6th meeting, Mr. Reeves, you may be suggesting, and a motion was made and actually passed upon to require the school to do that. Then Madam Clerk, is that correct?
Sir, I'm sorry.
Did we take a vote on that?
Yes.
So, and it was unanimous vote by this board that we go that route. So it is a binding.
I think we're saying two different things.
Mr. Reeves, I understand what you're saying. I don't mean to interrupt. But I think the message that we gave the school board with that vote was that, because they've had this on their CIP, we've had it on our CIP. And so the expectations of our board and their board was that we need to move on these projects, but we said to the school board, we want the public to buy in as well. And so the school board takes that motion and they act upon it because this is the expectation all along that we are going to get these projects accomplished. And now we've got to have the public buy-in. So I think in good faith, they accepted that challenge. They've gone about doing what they have to do. And from what I can tell, we've still got a good working relationship, even though the way we go about building this school is very different than we went about this last one, because we went through COPS, which didn't involve the public. So anyway, I have a totally different take than you, but I feel like the school board is responding to what it was that we said when we know we've had conversations. Certainly, I've been on the board for 4 years about the expectations of when we're going to try to get these things accomplished. So to just rob them of all that, I don't think is going to be a good working relationship at all.
I'm not following how a robbery takes place in this discussion.
Well,
what I said was that if a decision to build was made, that it should go before the public. That, in my mind, does not lock me in to doing it when the school board decides to do it. That's not what it does. As a matter of fact, if you talk about working relationships, it may have been better to come to the board or at least send notice to the board in advance that this is what we intend to do, to talk about where we are financially. The mere fact that you have made a statement that says we ought to include the public doesn't mean we can afford it at that particular time. That's a difference.
Yeah, and to me, we didn't make a statement. We made a motion, and this is and voted on it, and the way the school board received it was, this is your next course of action, is to, you know, to have to get public buy-in. So they came to us and said that they wanted to...
They came to us? I read it in the paper. I read that in the paper. I had no contact with the Board of Education. Maybe you did, but I didn't.
No, I didn't. And I'll say to you that, you know, they didn't know that we were going to come up with this vote about asking them to go after a bond referendum. So we've done the same thing.
My financial responsibility is not to answer to the Board of Education, it's to answer to the public.
I understand.
So all I'm saying to you is that because a statement is made and a board takes a vote on how we proceed does not mean it gives you the go-ahead to step out and have those expectations. You can do that if you choose. That doesn't make it right, but you can do that. I'm simply saying it wasn't a mandate. It wasn't an order for them to approach the public or ask for a referendum. That's not what it was about. And I'm just trying to say to you that I don't like for that to be spread around. That's not what my intent was. Now, how the board accepted and chose to move forward on it, that's a board decision we made.
And what we're looking at, we're fully mindful that this body has a fiduciary responsibility for the physical well-being of the county. Mr. Reeves, what we were looking at is when we had Lee County High School as a priority of one, our top priority. As a result of the actions of the previous board in selling the COPS for the middle school and Florida L9, we collectively and individually looked at the computer internet and saw, and after reading in the newspaper the action taken, we reviewed the discussions that this board, the board, this commissioner board had on December 4th. At that time, we didn't have any other interpretation that it was now our responsibility to go to the public in a referendum. At the same time, I have no, while I'm disappointed, I have no problem with the fact that I attended with Mr. Brown the LGC meeting with Ms. Mentor, and we heard Davenport's presentation and the amount of money that it would cost, starting at $16 million with $2 million increments up through $22 million. I without sounding that I'm putting any blame other than on my own shoulders, I'd just like to say, suffice it to say, that I've had communication before we began. So if you'll accept that, you know, for what it's worth. But at no time was there ever an indication that, and I don't think our board, while our board was terribly disappointed, we've all gotten over it. It's not changed the fact that we've got a priority at Lee County High School. So how we are funded certainly is at your discretion, not ours.
Tell me what, if we just, okay, let's just go build a brand new high school somewhere. What are estimates? I mean, what, the ballpark? Size of leasing.
The size of that school, what they estimated is $45 to $50 million.
How much is that property worth? Could we sell it to a private developer and build a new school?
I haven't explored that.
I think part of my problem, Bill, are the expectations haven't been conveyed. And when I see a request for $25 million come through, I want to see the detail and I want to see the phases. What's the first priority? Do we need windows and doors and roofs? You know, can that be done first? So I want to see what's going to cost entirely, but I want to see the detail. And I'm a little concerned that, you know, we've had Boeing and Associates do things in the past and whatever, so I'm wondering if we pay excess money to different people to do the same thing and come up with the same results. So that's my expectations. I want to see this prioritized. You know, phase one, what's the critical things that need to be done here? And in a method that maybe we can afford. But with 25 million, we saw absolutely no detail.
As an explanation, no excuse, we were working on a timeline. The timeline where we stepped across the line, I take full responsibility as chairman of our board, we crossed the line on setting a referendum date. And when we set that, it compressed everything we were trying to do. When I was contacted about the vote taken here a month ago, I saw it as a glass half full and stated it in the news when the newspaper reporter called it. Because now we have that opportunity to give you that detail. When Mr. Height presented it, again, because of the timeline given to us to operate on, was the February 2nd meeting at LGC. We had a February 20th meeting with the architect to bring his first rendering of concept. They met on February the, I'll get my dates crossed up, I believe they met on February the 12th, actually. And February the 12th, the architect met with the facilities committee and gave the number not to exceed as a result of our visit with LGC. When LGC instructed us to have a number because of meeting specific deadlines of not to exceed. What we have now, you will be, there will be a letter forthcoming to, from me to Mr. Brown, inviting both boards to hear at the same time Mr. Height's presentation of time, of phases, the actual detail as you just described that you wanted to hear. So we have not heard that either. And that's why I'm saying it's not all negative. I don't look at this as negative at all. It's given all of us time to step back and catch our breath. So that, therefore, there will be an opportunity for significant dialogue with the seven of you and the seven of us at the presentation. And right now, we've tentatively scheduled that for April 24th, but it's tentative. We don't know that Mr. Height will have that prepared by then. We don't know that's going to be a good day for the majority of this board.
When I'm looking at your Lee County High School renovations for next fiscal year, you know, that $5.2 million, you do have it broken down a little bit. $425,000 is engineering architectural services, and then building slash utility construction, about $4.6 million. So even at that, I would like to know the detail of that. Mm-hmm. And so that's, you know, I want it broken down. I want to know that there has been a process to arrive at these numbers rather than just ballparking and guessing.
Well, they're not ballparking, but what you have there is a document sent to us to complete to send back to this department, to the county manager's department. But those, all the detail behind those, that that sheet is in our office, but all of that is like a question answer. The sheet that you have there is as a request that has been presented over the past few years.
Lisa, if the state general assembly passes that sales tax, is that just for new construction, or could that be used for renovations like this?
I believe the way y'all structured it could be used for renovations and repairs.
Any word on that? Is, I mean, any chance of that? What do we hear from Jimmy Love?
Well, we just got it submitted last week, I think, to the House and also to the Senate. So we really don't know where it's going, and Mr. Love is going to be in contact and let us know when we need to do something. Right now, there's nothing we can do until it's assigned to committee, and then we try to get it heard in committee. That's what we did last time.
The County Commissioner Association has sent out the counties that have already asked for it. They've sent that information out to all the other counties asking, are they wanting to sign on to that bill? So they're kind of doing the research right now to see how many counties are really interested in going that route.
The last I've heard on the 1 cent sales taxes, Mr. Love submitted the bill, I think last Thursday, for Lee County. There are other counties around the state that have similar bills. What he anticipates happening, they'll all be consolidated into one bill. There are many efforts being made, according to, I had breakfast with Mr. Love this morning. There's a lot of ways that different legislatures are trying to assist the counties on the burden of school construction. And this is one of them. Another way that a lot of counties are addressing it is a 1% land transfer tax, impact fees on development. And that seems to be gaining more momentum than the 1 cent sales tax, because there's a fair amount, according to Mr. Little, there's a fair amount of opposition to that, simply because the state likes to control that sales tax. And they're a little reluctant to allow individual counties to determine a sales tax referendum. Any other questions? I'm sorry, I couldn't answer.
We still have hanging also this possibility of the statewide school bond issue. And if that went as it is now anticipated, Lee County would not realize, about $14 million?
As is currently written for proposal, it's $16,799,000.
A little more than I thought.
That's certainly not enough.
And that's not enough to do what we want to do.
Well, the problem with that, some arm that proposed this and the different lobbying groups have joined in with it. The state of North Carolina's needs in public school construction is in excess of $9 billion. And they're proposing a $2 billion. So they're putting a Band-Aid on a major artery. So that's why we're not getting, we're actually, because of our low wealth status, we actually get more money out of it than our neighboring county in Moore County is at $16 million.
We appreciate your being here, Bill. Mm-hmm. As I said, I think before.
I'm glad to be here, and I'm glad to address any of these concerns. And I
hope that you realize, and that our citizens of the county realize, that we're going to do what we can, but we can only do what we can afford.
I think everybody understands that. Yeah.
Mr. Chairman, let me ask one question. I don't know who directed to, whether it be Bill or Ms. Minner. Listening to the news the other day and reading the paper where they were talking about the governor taking money out of the lottery, roughly how much would that decrease the amount that we're supposed to receive? Do you have any idea, either one?
I haven't seen new projections run based on the governor's proposal yet. I don't know
if
you have.
No, but I'll just do some simple math. Where we've been getting 35, where it's been allocated at 35%.
But at 29%.
He's going to drop it to 6%. So if we're at 600,000, according to Davenport, we would be looking at 94% of 600,000.
But the governor's looking to sell more lottery tickets, because that some of that money, at least, is going back to prizes, isn't it? Mm-hmm. So he's anticipating making up the difference, and I hope he does.
I've served a career of dealing with salesmen, and I've had salesmen tell me that many a time. So you can get a dollar for your watermelon, selling more of them at 50 cents, and that's, you're going to make more money.
Well, I'm just telling you what he said.
I think, further down here, on what some people think, I said earlier, voted on. Then why, if what I hear being suggested is that was a mandate for the school board to move forward, then why wouldn't it be a mandate for the community college to move forward in the same light to get their projects on?
I don't know that it was a mandate for the school board to move forward, but I think it was just a statement that if we did move forward.
That's all I said. That's what I said.
The referendum was going to be the way.
But that's what I said, and it didn't have anything to do with instructing anyone to move. It just said, if we did. Okay, well, as long as we're clear on that problem. Because if that's the case, then the community college ought to include their $11.5 million projects after we just heard the complete building here. But that's not what I was.
I don't know where you're coming from.
All right.
Okay, move on. What else do we need to discuss, Ms. Manor? What questions does any commissioner have? This is just a work session. Nothing is going to be decided tonight. You want to wait until we get the final?
Well, I have just one comment, one question. And I guess I should have asked Mr. Garrett while he was here. I got to get it. But I just wonder why, you know, they've got, and they have for the last couple of years, had people from the Jonesboro Center to come and request that we go ahead and build this building, yet it is not in the community college's CIP from what I can get until the year 2010, 2011.
So David put that down. It was actually requested in 2008,
2009. Okay.
So I'm just the recommended portion of that you have there.
Okay.
I think David wanted to get that right.
Yeah. Was that 5 million like renovations out there, or is that?
It's actually building a new building over, I believe it's on the new land that was purchased this year. At the community college.
Now, how does the arrangement go with the Jonesboro School? There's an arrangement.
It's leased by the Central Carolina Community College for, I believe, $1.
$1 a year?
From the Board of Education.
Okay.
So is that building beyond repair?
That's what I wonder. I mean, I guess
we're going out there for a meeting. We'll look at it. I ain't been out
there. There is a lot of work that needs to be on. I've been to a couple of meetings there in the past, one of them about 4 years ago.
That's it going on in school.
Did you go to school there?
Yeah. I laid root there.
I'll stop out there.
Well,
I had no idea they had that many students there. That's a lot of students.
That's a lot of students.
I started to say, you can stop by anytime. There'll be somebody available to take you,
show you around. I don't know where it is. Is it on the...
That's the Chevrolet place. You take that little beat.
You see a little sign. You go to the left.
The stop by.
That's the Chevrolet.
Just before you get to where the new Walmart's going to be, take a left.
Oh, okay.
At the stoplight.
Yeah, right behind the car there.
Cox Maddox Room.
So at least we don't have to have this thing approved before we know what our budget is.
Yes, ma'am. We need to know where you are on this document to be able to incorporate it into the budget process and into setting the recommended tax rate.
Well, the copy that we have tonight, is that what we need to act on?
If I understood the Mr. Tatum,
not tonight.
Right, no.
You need to give her some guidance on where to head.
If I understood Mr. Tatum, we could move the issuance of the school debt to 2008-2009 fiscal year, that we could issue that, probably that's spring of 2008 or summer of 2008, which could push that out another year and possibly push the first principal payment into 2009-2010, if I understood that correctly.
For clarity, I think before the commissioners, it should be for consideration their own priority on the renovations at that high school. If we have the opportunity to go forward, as I stated, I didn't realize this myself until our own public hearing or public meeting when the question was raised, to do the survey of that site, the the drawings of buildings that will remain, the footprint of the foundations of the buildings that will remain, and all the survey of underground utilities, and the engineering phase is going to take roughly until January of next year. The actual timing of, if it's a decision that we go to a general referendum, then the general referendum, as I said, if it was in November, joint board approval, if it was November, I don't think, I'm stepping over in an area I'm not familiar with, Ms. Mentor, but I don't think you would be looking at substantial funding until July, because it would be, you help me with this, because the best scenario today would be a bid letting on or about mid to late April of next year with a start date of June the 10th. So I can't answer exactly how that would work, but that, as we sit here today, that's the best scenario.
Well, I think what Ms. Mentor has asked for this meeting tonight has to do with the 4 years that we're going to put for the claims, the tax rate. And projecting out for the next 3 years after this year, correct?
Right.
Without raising taxes. I think everybody's strangely silent.
You ain't doing much if you ain't. You know, this is not an inexpensive venture here we got for us. Well, then, I mean, you have to make some very serious decisions on, or at least get your mind focused on doing these projects that are going to require some money, pure and simple. And this board needs to take a position that if it intends to proceed and to do more than just that school, then you're going to have to pay something.
So we've got to set a tax rate this for the coming fiscal year that's going to enable us to accomplish what we want to accomplish.
Which in my mind
and live with it for 4 years.
You hope you can live with it for 4 years.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, you hope you can live with it for 4 years. And that's why it is still this commission's position that we take our time and study this issue. You know, one of the things I will tell you is that at some point, we've got to start looking at how to get more out of our building program. We've got to we have got to start looking at singular purposes. If you look at what we have before us, let's use, for example, a library we've been talking about for several years. And there ought to be a better library and a universal library and one that more than Hawkins Avenue can use. There ought to be one. But in the same breath, I say to you, as it is in this CIP, $1.5 million for elementary land acquisition. Chairman Tatum, do you know how much excess land the school board currently has? Have any idea?
As far as an excess property, it would be what was just discussed at the old Jonesboro Elementary that's being rented to.
No, you got that? No. Some of these schools have got large tracts attached to them.
Like Eastern and West.
Yes, I know.
From that standpoint, there's a lot of the campuses. For example, Tramway.
Mr. Shipp was saying a few minutes ago about selling properties. The Board of Education should be in the land business, where we have built schools and the additions are no longer necessary. Those tracts ought to be available for public consumption.
We have a situation like we got out in Southern Lee in the new middle school that we're building there.
That's right. So there are lots of things here that this board ought to be taking a look at. There are other ways to serve, even in this proposal, the Lee Senior renovation. you have a third high school sitting down the CCCC campus, that if it continues to grow, you're going to have a building for it. And you've got land right up the street there. You've got land right across the street. There are things that we're going to have to take our time and take a serious look at and meet with these other boards and at least put these things on the table.
Also, we need to also look at corporate, joint corporate sponsorship for land. I know that there's a current, Mr. Kurt Bradley talked about this at the Committee 100 meeting and talking about his developments he had, the Governor's Club that he had done up there, and was stating that some of these new developers, I know that there's a tract right now that a current developer has on the Deep River, that you know, he said, you know, a good corporate sponsor sets aside land for a middle school or elementary school, and you know, if you want to, you know, we need to kick it up a notch for as a community, and that's a way that we all benefit. And even, hey, you want to build a school and lease it back to us. Those are the kinds of things that will end up saving us money. Mr. Tatum.
We are currently exploring the law that was passed in the last legislative session on private-public partnership. We are involved in that as we speak, and I'd like not to say much beyond this, but the fact that if we could cordon off the necessary acres from some of these developers that seems to be having an interest in the northern part of the county, that if we could cordon off and they donate acreage for a school, and then we in turn enter into a private-public partnership, then it would be a significant difference in that CIP, a significant difference.
Well, you're talking about leasing instead of building a building that we don't have to maintain and own, and we're a lot better off if we go that route.
I'd like Wake County to look at something similar.
If, for example, if you put this on referendum in November of 07, which year do you think you're going to have the greatest public turnout, 07 or 08, on the presidential and gubernatorial election? So when you start looking at how this could work, then you have to consider those kinds of things, because the cost, one, is going to be taken care of, right? That's almost an automatic. And the cost is going to be less for us in the long run. I still will tell you, this board needs some time to think through these numbers.
Okay, so we want to work on it a little bit, and we'll study it individually and have another work session later on.
These are going to raise the money.
It's just the school thing.
Right, and the only thing that you've got different is the schools, and you know, if you don't have another work session, I can incorporate the school's numbers into how they would have played into.
And maybe we can have somebody from Davenport.
I'll be glad to.
That might help us.
Based on what we've been told today and these new numbers, I'll be glad to have Davenport run some new numbers. If you set another work session, I'm sure Ted and our Bob would be here. I do know at the last work session, there were some questions about the industrial park. Mr. Cole has been in contact with Mr. Hutz if you have any questions on that tonight.
Well, and we've got Sand League Dam that we've got to consider also. This is a pressing issue.
Mr. Cole has informed me, brought me up to date on that, or he can answer your questions on Sand League Dam.
I'll see
you
while we're here.
I'd like to see our board either establish a little steering committee to work on this. I just feel like say, well, we're going to work on this a little bit more. We're going to be in the same place the next time we meet.
And, you know, we heard about our jail situation, and we've got other needs out there that, again, that we talked about earlier, they're not addressed in this CIP. And either we go ahead and establish this group that's going to help take a look at all these situations, or we can establish our own with the schools, or however we go about it. But I think we've got to have a working group, because it's not going to happen with us just going home and taking a look at it and coming back, because, you know, you can bring up this suggestion and bring up that suggestion. It's not going to go anywhere. So I think it needs to be more formalized than that.
Well, the formal way in the past has been for the Finance Committee to meet and make recommendations to the board. That's been a formal way. That's always the way it's been recommended. But for some reason, years ago, this board got away from it.
And that was what I was going to suggest, maybe the Finance Committee, member Mr. Cole could meet and try to iron some of these things out. And of course, after the budget, we do have a budget, and the Finance Committee is going to have to meet on that. You know?
Okay, and the Finance Committee is Mr. Reeves, Mr. Kelly, and
me.
I'm good with that.
Would that be satisfactory, Robert? You're chairman of the Finance Committee.
Yeah, so that's fine, but I'd like to hear what Ms. Cole has to say about those other two projects.
Okay. Sandy Dam, there's really no additional information. I was asked by a board member to get a quote, a local person to do the, go ahead and include the design work, and he said it was a project too big for him. So I'm actually trying to go out now and solicit prices to do the design. That way, if the state comes back at us, starts us in a violation, at least we have something going on, not just sort of sitting around the project. Myself, Mr. Hall, and Mr. Hutes met.
Excuse me before you leave down. Do you know the value of the properties on the homes down below?
I do not know the value. I know there's 5 homes on the whole way.
Could you get the value and
sure.
Consider those versus, and I don't know, do you know if they have flood insurance?
I do not know. And I'm concerned too. I'm trying to get Strategic Services to update that plan to make sure that nobody else, for some reason, has put some structure in the flood zone. But I think as long as the state sees us moving forward with the project, that was my interpretation, that we would be
good faith effort.
Well, that's fine, but I still think, one, we ought to know the value of those homes, and two, we ought to know if they've got flood insurance. That could be very serious.
Like I said, Mr. Hull and I met with Mr. Hughes last week, discussed the industrial park. And basically, he gave us an outline of what is developed. And I don't know if you want to hear the whole process, but basically, there were 3 streams that were left off of the permitting process. And I think that time, Hummingbird was in the process. Mr. Hutes had a remediation plan submitted to the Corps after they came out. So that's in a draft form, and that's what the Corps has now. And what that included was one of these streams actually building a bridge for the remediation. He did say in his CIP, he did include, I think it was $500,000 or $600,000 to build a bridge along with some road improvements and water line improvements. And we're still in discussion with the MS consultants about future issues.
Is that out of the $2 million?
Mm-hmm. That included the remediation, the on the draft form that was submitted to the Corps of Engineers. What I suggested to Mr. Hughes was to maybe meet with the Corps and resubmit a remediation plan minus the bridge, maybe dedicating some additional wetland area as a trade-off. And hopefully that would work. And he is trying to get in touch with some consulting companies to develop a plan.
If for some reason that goes south on us, how much land would it actually remove from that park?
It's not a whole lot. I mean, it really depends on after we meet with them. Mm-hmm. But there were some creeks in there, sort of the upper part of the watershed, mm-hmm. that we think that could be developed into some wetland areas, or not developed, but dedicated as wetland areas. That has been done in the past. It just all depends on how, what kind of move there are when you get in there, so. But I understand Mr. Hughes's urgency with the project going on to quickly submit a remediation plan to Corps. And my thing is now is can we back up and resubmit another one? Because it was only in draft format. And I suggested that we contact the Corps or either have a consultant engineer contact them, discuss the possibilities of that. If they're totally in, not in favor of it, then we're going to have to move forward and with the bridge and start a remediation work. But just, you know, we've got to make some attempt to contact them, you know, to see if we can, I don't want to say back out of the bridge, but see if there's some other process that we can take.
That land on the lower portion of that plot, isn't it?
Right. Yeah. And just to let you know, there were six rings and three of them were missed.
Well, it,
when they were doing the Hummingbird, it didn't have much of the land, but it changed the use of the road back there.
Right, they talked about moving the road.
Well, it was what they had proposed with the Hummingbird project was to take the culvert out of the stream and just put dead end cul-de-sacs on both sides. And that was more like a little remediation plan, a quick solution. But when all that backed out, there was no reason to move any roads or.
Well, I agree, but they also said when they made that offer, then we had to buy, or I remember being built another 100 some acres for Hummingbird to offset the use of that road. So that's what concerns me. And do you know if we put a bridge in, is that going to be the cure-all?
That should be the cure-all. That is the draft plan submitted to the Corps. That's the reason I would love to meet the Corps to find out, is this going to actually satisfy them before we go forward?
That's right.
The same people don't stay in the same job.
And I think that's what's happening, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Well, what was the grant, Jerry, that you were working on for the dam?
It's one we're working on with environmental impact.
It's nothing to do with what we need here?
No. But that one is with the dam project itself, you know.
Dam project itself.
San Lee Park Dam. To go in and you know, completely redo the spillway and possibly go in there and fix the problems with the dam itself. The parapet wall, that 3-foot parapet wall, raise it several more foot.
3/4 foot.
I understand. So you're saying that if that grant came through, that could postpone what we need to do here?
It would help us.
It would help us on this
949,000.
Well, and Mr. Cole and Mr. Lamont and myself were in Washington the week before last, and we presented this project, the San Lee Dam project, to both of our senators up there. We met physically with Senator Dole for about an hour and met with Senator Burr's top aides. And we're trying to get some help from the federal government on this project.
And we submitted appropriation forms this week, so that's last week.
Right.
So we're doing. And I told the lady with state with Denver that we're doing all we could do, and
as long as we have documentation that we're presenting.
And like I said, we're doing all we can do.
You know, I'm gonna ask you a question, and if I am making you repeat yourself, I apologize. Now, the land that we have got, that bridge there, or that stream that we have to do this remediation over, we don't own that land, right?
Correct.
We don't. So we have an option on it. And so right now, is there a road that goes through it?
Yes, sir.
And who owns the road?
That would have been accepted by Department of Transportation.
Okay.
It was submitted to
the road is what goes over the stream.
Right.
Okay.
Now, I say that Department of Transportation, I think there's was it so many months before they'll actually take it over, I believe. I'll have to check on that.
Okay, so are we remediating it for DOT, or are we doing...
No, the Corps of Engineers.
The Corps of Engineers, but why is it our responsibility at this point when we don't own the road?
Well, I think we own the road.
We own the road.
Currently, we own it, but it will be turned over to Department of Transportation.
Yeah, that's what I didn't, okay.
Lee County had to submit the permitting to Dinger and the Corps to build the road.
Okay.
Do we have a list of buildings that the county currently owns that maybe are not being, do we have any vacant buildings, or?
We don't have any vacant, I know.
No, we have...
We had to go, got pictures of most of all.
Yeah, we don't have anything vacant. We have, the federal building is half vacant. It's been filled up with storage stuff.
Federal building, the old post office?
No, I'm sorry, it's called the courthouse annex. That's the only one we have right now that's half vacant.
And we, there's a fee, or a fine on this, could be, right?
San Lee.
Actually, on both.
On both?
On both.
And when, are we taking care of so we don't start to incur?
It'll be whenever they come down and see what progress we make.
We're just sort of there.
Well, that was my point to Mr. Hughes too, is we have to move forward. Bob did agree with us, we have to move forward to make contact with them. We can't sit here and wait for them to contact us.
Right.
Because I think the longer we wait, the worse it might be. Like I said, nobody knows when they'll come down.
And we need to show good favor, and I think we'll be okay as long as we show them that in good favor.
I think we have, as long as you don't sit there and not say anything at all, I think you're okay. But if you just sit there and let it mull over them, that's not what they want to hear.
You on top of it?
Doing my best.
All right, do I hear a motion that we turn this situation over to the Finance Committee, let them work with Ms. Minner, and come back to the full board when we figure out something or...
So I do, Mr. Chairman.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed say no. It's so ordered. It kind of seems like we're kind of spinning our wheels right now. We need to get some traction, some things, nail things.
We'll do it the next week.
Okay, do I hear a motion that we adjourn?
So moved.
Any discussion? All those in favor of adjourning say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed say no. So ordered, and I appreciate your diligence and your input.